On Monday, scientists announced that they had made the very first entirely computer-generated bacterial genome. And just to be clear, they didn't actually make the bacterium. They made a really big piece of DNA shaped like a ring, and they detailed the process in a paper published in the journal Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Still, it's a big step forward for the field of synthetic biology, and it demonstrates just how far genetics technologies have progressed. The new synthetic genome was based on the genome of the real-life freshwater bacterium Colobacter crescentis. So scientists called the fake organism they had created a genome for Colobacter effensis 2.0. Their goal was to make a ring of DNA that would still code for the same proteins as the bacterial genome, but with fewer actual nucleotides. So to trim things down, they started with only the genes that C. crescentis needs for survival, also called its minimal genome. That narrowed down the DNA strand from around 4,000 genes to 676, plus some non-coding and between gene sequences. The result was a roughly 785 kilobase genome, but when they tried to synthesize it, they found that they couldn't. That's because natural genomes have certain patterns of bases and other features that make synthesis really difficult. So they rewrote the genome using a computer algorithm they'd created. You see, there are several different letter sequences or codons that code for the same amino acid. So this algorithm replaced over half of the genetic code with synonymous codons. And they streamlined the genome, too. There are sections of the DNA that code for the same protein, but in a different way, kind of like a backup, and sections that control the process of gene expression, like speeding it up or fine-tuning it. And there are sequences called hypothetical genetic elements that scientists think make proteins, but they're not entirely sure what their function is. The algorithm got rid of almost all of those. In all, they changed over 120,000 nucleotides and removed thousands of features that impede synthesis. That allowed them to make 3 to 4 kilobase sections of the DNA in the lab, and then piece them all together to make the entire 785 kilobase Colobacter effensis 2.0 genome. What's really impressive about this research, though, is how little time it took, relatively speaking. When scientists made the first synthetic genome of a different bacterium 11 years ago, it took them 10 years, 20 scientists, and $40 million. And while the previous team made an exact copy of a natural genome, this new team changed the genome completely using their computer algorithm. This genome was made in only 1 year with 13 scientists and around $120,000. But it turns out that only about 81.5% of the new genome actually worked. This is actually kind of a good thing because it showed scientists that some of the genetic elements that they'd thought weren't important actually are essential. From here, the researchers hope to improve their computer algorithm so their next rewriting effort creates a more functional genome. By making genomes much shorter and simpler, scientists think they might be able to actually design whole functional bacteria. And these bacteria could do some pretty useful things, like make molecules that we can use as pharmaceuticals. But the ability to artificially make new genomes, however small, could be misused. There's the ever-looming concern that such work could intentionally or unintentionally make a devastating pathogen or an ecosystem-disrupting microbe. There are strict regulations in place already that limit the synthesis of known harmful organisms, and in many countries, biological products that are made to be sold, including genetically modified or synthetic organisms, are regulated by several agencies. But when it comes to modifying or synthesizing the genomes of otherwise harmless species in the lab, experimenters are mostly guided by standard scientific ethics and practices. That might be okay for now, but the researchers say that their success underscores the need to further discuss how we can best ensure nothing makes it out of a lab that could cause harm. In other medical news, researchers have found a way to surgically operate without making any cuts or leaving any scars. That means recovery time is essentially zero, and the whole procedure could take around 5 minutes. Seriously. Instead of a scalpel and sutures, this new, quote, molecular surgery technique uses an electric current, small needles, and a 3D-printed mold to reshape living tissue. The electric current softens cartilage and makes it moldable. When the current is removed, the cartilage keeps the shape. See, cartilage, as well as other body parts like the front layer of the eye or blood vessels, are made of tiny, stiff fibers of collagen, as well as negatively charged proteins proteins and positively charged sodium ions. The more these charged particles there are in one particular area, the stiffer the tissue is. The electric current cancels out some of the negatively charged proteins with the help of any water that's in the tissue. See, the electricity splits or hydrolyzes the water into oxygen molecules and positively charged hydrogen ions, which temporarily cancel out some of the other charges. And less charge overall makes for floppier tissues that you can then mold. Then, when you take the electric current away, the cancellation effect stops and the tissue stiffens again. The researchers who pioneered this technique presented it at a meeting of the American Chemical Society on Tuesday. They showed that they were able to reshape a rabbit ear from pointing straight up to permanently having a kink in it. And they say that a similar technique could fix all sorts of health issues, like a deviated septum, where the cartilage dividing the nose is crooked, making breathing more difficult. They also made a contact lens with electrodes on it that was able to soften the front layer of the eye, the cornea, and change its shape in animal models. That's great news if you are a glasses wearer and don't want to be, unlike me, I like my glasses, but it could replace laser eye surgery. But it is not like you can scroll down to your local doctor and get this new kind of surgery right now. The scientists who discovered this technique are looking to commercialize it, but it will have to pass a lot of stringent testing, not to mention peer review, before it could be made available to the general public. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow News. We want to give a special thanks to our president of space, Matthew Brandt, and thank you to all of the other awesome people who help support SciShow as patrons on Patreon. We actually have an exciting Patreon announcement today. We're rolling out a new reward, SciShow After Hours. So we make a lot of videos here at SciShow, but there are tons of topics that don't make it onto the channel. Usually we cut them because they're not quite, like, family-friendly enough for our general content. But we still think those things are fascinating, and our writing staff wants to tell people about them. So we've decided to produce a short monthly podcast just for our patrons. Anyone pledging $4 or more on Patreon will get to listen to one of our editors regularly astound, amaze, and appall me and possibly other SciShow hosts. There's a sample episode up right now where Christy Wilcox tells me about some pretty weird fish, which you can check out for yourself for free at patreon.com/scishow. If you think it's as fun as we do, please join our Patreon community for monthly episodes.